campaign that is looming. Multiple games coming up, and I do mean multiple games coming up later this week in the Power Five, but we head to the West Coast. Can't wait to catch up with my man Jarrid Dinney, ScoopDuck.com, stepping into the arena. Jarrid, what's up, big guy? How are you, man? Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, absolutely. How are you?
Man, I'm great. I tell you what, this is so unique, I think, for so many perspectives, from so many perspectives when we talk about the ACC, the Pac-12, the Big Ten coming together. I know how the East Coast feels. I know what we've been talking about here in the ACC territory. Give me the scoop. What's going on out there as far as the folks in the Pac-12 and how they feel about the arrangement that was set forth today?
I think Pac-12 folks are, I mean, they're cautiously optimistic, but they're sort of like everybody else in the sense that they're trying to untangle what exactly all the news today means. And I mean, as you know, it's going to take a while until we sort of get sorted out what exact impact this has on the programs in terms of non-conference matchups and that sort of thing. But yeah, I think just overall, it's such an exciting move for, I mean, in the case of the Pac-12, they've had a few really rocky recent years. Under the Larry Scott tenure. So it's just really nice to get out from under the umbrella of that and have a commissioner who, I mean, seems to be, if anything, really forward thinking and willing to do some moves that are, you know, for the betterment of the conference.
Jarrid Dinney again, ScoopDuck.com with us here on Clemson Sports Talk today. Jarrid, my question would be, if the Pac-12 had been in six out of the seven college football playoffs instead of two, would there be that conversation that this push has been made as much by the Pac-12? Or do you think this is a byproduct of them sort of being on the outside of the college football playoff since 2017 when Washington last made an appearance?
I think it's the latter. I think it's a really good point. If you had Oregon or USC or Washington kind of constantly like knocking on the door for that consistent college football playoff spot, this probably wouldn't be as big of an issue. But the fact of the matter is you just haven't had the elite teams you would hope to see forcing the envelope on that the last few years. And I think with Oregon, that Mario Cristobal is building an absolute giant out here and has been recruiting as well as anybody in the country. And I think you're going to see that eventually happen. But for the time being, I think this is sort of, like you said, just a really good way for the conference to secure a little bit more say in how that unfolds over the next few years.
Now, one of the things that I thought about is, again, schedules are already put together so far out and games can certainly change, but how difficult is it as a guy that lives on the West Coast when you start to recognize how late your games are sometimes available to the folks that live where I am here on the East Coast? I mean, a 7 o'clock kickoff for you guys, boy, I'm sure that's a beautiful game. It's not so beautiful over here on the East Coast at 10 o'clock.
No. I remember I used to feel the same way and love the 7 o'clock kicks. And then I moved out to the Midwest for an internship for a little bit and was always super pumped to, you know, watch the Ducks and watch some of the Pac-12 teams that I really enjoy watching. And I'm like, oh yeah, that's an 11:30 kick. This is going to be miserable. So you're right. It's hard. I mean, we have a little bit of tunnel vision out here on the West Coast. That suggests how hard it can be to get kind of national recognition when your games are ending at 2 o'clock in the morning on the East Coast. So, and I think the new Pac-12 regime has already made some efforts to sort of alleviate that and scheduling early kicks and like Oregon and Ohio State, that's a noon kick Eastern time. That's obviously a lot better for the product. So I think that as much of that as that's been an issue in the past, it's something that hopefully isn't going to be as big of a factor in the future.
Again, ScoopDuck.com is the website. Jarrid Dinney and those guys, they do a tremendous job covering not only the Oregon Ducks, but college football and all the major sports out there in Eugene. And look, I mentioned to the listeners, I haven't gotten into it today about some of the news coming out of LSU, so I'll save that for later. But you guys in Oregon State were a couple of the first programs to come out and announce that, hey, you got to either have a negative COVID-19 test or be vaccinated to venture into the stadiums this season. I mean, how has that been received by everybody out that way?
It's it's been received, you know, fairly well. It's just kind of an ever shuffling subject out here. Just today, Oregon's governor announced that masks will not be required outside for the foreseeable future. So it's just one of those things where each day there's like a new bit of news coming out. But for the most part, it's just difficult. Like in Eugene, Lane County, the county where we're located, there's a really bad wave of COVID spike right now. So I think a lot of people are just sort of looking at it like, you know, whatever we have to do to watch football in person this year, we're going to do, because last year it's just so brutally sad to have an empty Austin stadium. So there's always going to be people who are upset about it, as there is in any situation or in any place. But for the most part, I think it's being greeted with a lot of just let's do whatever we have to do to make this happen.
Now, just kind of dipping back into the Alliance for a few minutes here with Jarrid Dinney. And Jarrid, I want to confirm, because I do have a break coming up in about 2 minutes. Will you be able to hold through the break? Because I want to get in with you a little bit about this monster, this juggernaut that Mario Cristobal, you say, is building out there, and get your thoughts on Oregon's schedule. So can you hang with us through the break when we have one here in a few minutes?
Oh, yeah, you bet.
Okay, awesome. So let's get back to this alliance real quick. Give me, in your opinion, what are the benefits for, say, the ACC? In this deal, we've kind of talked about what some of the benefits are for the Pac-12. What are the benefits for the Atlantic Coast Conference, in your opinion?
You know, that's one of the questions I've been asking myself. And as I'm listening back to the press conference and reading back to the press releases, I'm sort of trying to figure out what the angle is here. And you guys probably have a much better idea than I do. But I guess like the obvious thing is that if you end up somewhere down the road, like Clemson and Oregon home and home, or Penn State and USC home and home, or something like that. Like, that's obviously a very lucrative matchup. And that's, I think, on the surface, what fans are going to be most excited about. And obviously, with kind of the bureaucracy of college football, there's always a lot more going on behind the scenes. But in terms of just overall product on the field, I think that's the thing that, I mean, I am miles ahead of sort of being most excited about.
Well, my question would be, and actually we only got about 25 seconds, so I'll pump the brakes on that, and we'll hit a quick break here on the show today. But I'm going to come back. I want to get Jarrid's thoughts on how Clemson is viewed out west at this point, because we know how they're viewed in the SEC by a lot of teams. I want to get his idea on the Tigers as far as they go when it comes down to the Pac-12, and more specifically in the state of Oregon there. So, again, Jarrid Dinney, ScoopDuck.com. We'll hang through the break. Jarrid, I'm going to put you on hold, man. If you lose audio, don't panic. That's just the break. And we'll come back and talk a little bit more with him about everything going on in the world of college football right after this. Stay with us.
Men, this summer, don't sit.